William Topchev is here, an ex-Forbes columnist, AI lead and founder, and a sci-fi writer. Here on Scripted Channel, we explore AI and humans. When was the last time you tried to prove you are a human? Yeah, Captcha. Everybody hates it, as this is one of the most annoying things in the world. But we are anyway doing it almost every day. Well, what can we do, right? We need to prove that we are not robots. But what if I told you that we're not really proving that we are humans? No. Well, not really. In reality, capture is the most profitable business idea in the history of humankind. In the beginning, any newborn AI algorithm is clueless. It's like a helpless newborn kitten that is crawling and trying to figure out what this place around it, trying to find a way. It needs to be guided, to be trained. It needs somebody who will explain the wild world around it. But training is very difficult and time-consuming. It is like hiring a babysitter, a very, very expensive babysitter. For example, at a computer vision healthcare startup that I co-founded 6 years ago, it took us years before we trained the first functioning prototype. Training is the most challenging part of any AI system. So how do you find a babysitter for your AI baby? The idea behind Captcha was simple. You show a hard-to-recognize word to 6 different people, and if they all say that the word is, let's say, swim, then it is probably indeed a swim. So the machine now knows what is written on this image. Now it can read. It has been trained. And as a byproduct, he also confirms that the user is actually a human. Well, nice bonus. This is what is called the stealth AI learning. When an unsuspecting user does some simple action while actually training an AI model. It's like getting a free babysitter, a stealth way of making others work for you. It's almost sort of a Tom Sawyer of AI world. For those of us who are not too familiar with Mark Twain's Tom Sawyer, here's a quick debrief. It will be important for the story. So Tom Sawyer was a boy who needed to paint a fence. It's a boring and tiresome task that would have taken the entire weekend and not a very cheerful way to spend a weekend for a boy, right? But Tom was a clever boy. So when he saw his classmates approaching, Tom got a plan. He stood and he started to paint that fence. And he did it with so much joy on his face, obviously enjoying the painting process, that the classmates wanted to try it too. Tom resisted. He said, no, I want to paint it all myself. It is so much fun to paint and I want to do it myself. But they gave him an apple. And Tom reluctantly gave them the paintbrush and he let them paint the fence for him and got an apple. In psychology, this type of manipulation is called reverse psychology. This is when you make people wanting to do something that they otherwise would be hating doing it. And that's exactly what AI, what the Captcha does. In AI, this process is called stealth learning. Captcha was invented by a genius known under the name von Ahn. This guy realized that while an internet user is proving that he's not a robot, he could also do something useful, like to babysit an AI model. In 2009, Google acquired Captcha, and this is how we all now babysitting Google AI algorithms. And we, all 5 billion internet users on this planet, we are doing this for free. Okay, some of us may say, so what's the big deal about it? Well, have you noticed that at some point, all capture images suddenly became about roads? Like find a streetlight, find a car, find a bicycle. That's right. Capture quickly evolved from simple text recognition to an image recognition algorithm for driverless cars. Do you know that all driverless cabs that you can hail in the US now, and by the way, we're filming it in February 2024, so all the driverless cabs in the US, well, and in the world for this matter, so all the driverless cabs are owned by company Waymo, which is a subsidiary of, that's right, Google. This cab was trained by you. You trained it. We all trained it for free. And that's exactly how AI stealth learning works. How much did it cost to invent and build Captcha? Well, almost nothing. This is a super simple idea and literally just a few lines of code. How much value it created then? Well, if we look at it from this perspective, after Google acquired it in 2009, Captcha has enabled some of the most disrupting inventions of our century, like driverless cars and robots. Basically, Captcha has become a mother of AI. Okay, maybe a grandmother of AI. But in any case, without Captcha, I don't think AI would be possible. Or at the very least, it would take much, much more time to develop it. This technology, was one of the main reasons why Google was first to commercialize convolutional neural networks, which soon became the foundation of AI. How much value Google got from it? Well, it is hard to derive an exact number, but my guesstimate would be that it is measured in hundreds of billions of dollars. If you consider the values, like collateral value for the rest of the market or the rest of the world, if you wish, we are probably talking about trillions, many, many trillions of dollars. So it's a trillions of dollars that came virtually at no cost because we all babysat it for free. In front of us is arguably the greatest and the most profitable business idea of all times. Captcha. AI stealth learning. If you know another technology that generated so much value while requiring virtually no investments, let us all know in the comments. We're all keen to learn from you. Oh, Mr. Vonan, we bow to your genius. But, you know, there was another man who thought that he was even smarter than you are. His name was... What was his name? Oh, right. Elon. Do you see this driver? What do you think he's doing? Driving Tesla? Think again. He's actually training Elon Musk's driverless car algorithm. Anywhere in the world, each move a Tesla driver makes is recorded, sent to base, and used to train the driverless algorithm. Each Tesla car is an ultimate training machine, and each driver is a trainer, a free babysitter. That's how you train AI models. A reverse psychology. Mark Twain would be proud of you, Mr. Musk. Here's your apple. AI stealth learning is what separates winners from losers. For example, GM, which is a General Motors, has just wasted $8 billion on a failed robot taxi cruise. Somehow, GM has never even thought of using stealth AI learning, and now they're about to go extinct. This is a market capitalization of Tesla. And this is a market capitalization of GM. Well, you caught my drift. A stealth AI learning. In the AI world, and we all now living in the AI world, and so the AI stealth learning decides who survives, like Tesla and Google, and who goes into oblivion, like GM, Ford, Mercedes, Audi, and the rest of those relics. Wait a second, what is it? Can you hear it? That sound? Where it's coming from? What is it? Oh, I think I know what it is. ChatGPT has arrived. Do you know who has become one of the most frequent users of ChatGPT? That's right, coders. Virtually all coders that I personally know, they all have become addicted to ChatGPT, or to Copilot in some cases, which we can think of some sort of an equivalent of ChatGPT. Where previously a coder, human coder, needed 10 hours of work to write a script, a routine piece of a code, now all that coder has to do is to give ChatGPT a prompt, like a brief description of what has to be done, and then ChatGPT will write the code. That's it. And then the human coder then just simply checks the script and copy-pastes it. Where previously a human coder needed 10 hours, now he needs just one. Our coding friends here, they will say that what I'm saying is basically nonsense. They may even use the word bullshit. They will say that ChatGPT returns very raw code that never works from the first time, and then the coder, the human coder, has to correct it and resubmit the prompt. And this requires many, many, many iterations. Again and again, the human coder has to correct ChatGPT and give new inputs. Wait a second. I think it reminds me something. A familiar pattern, isn't it? That's right. It's not really a human that uses ChatGPT, no. It is ChatGPT that uses human to train itself. Here's how coders usually use ChatGPT. Let's say a human programmer needs to write a code, so he puts together a prompt with a brief description and submits it to ChatGPT. A few seconds later, ChatGPT returns a snippet with the code, and then the human coder takes it and runs it. In most cases, it turns out that the code has mistakes in it and it doesn't really work. So the human coder diagnoses the code, finds the errors, and submits a new prompt in which he explains the errors, and ChatGPT creates a new, revised code. In other words, a coder babysits ChatGPT. Human coders across the entire planet are currently busy training ChatGPT to code. They're babysitting their own replacement. A snake eating its own tail. And this is one of the main reasons why coding is no longer a human profession, because of the stealth AI learning. We have briefly touched this, the fact that coding is no longer a human profession in this video. And there will be more videos about it coming out soon, so subscribe so you don't miss it. In the comments, you often criticize me that I explain the problem, but I do not tell what to do about it. Well, sometimes there is a good reason for it. For example, in this case, in the case of AI stealth learning, is there anything that we humans can actually do about it, about Captcha, Tesla, and ChatGPT? Well, we basically have two options. The first one is to babysit the AI algorithm and to do it for free, but in return to remain competitive versus the rest of the crowd. So that's our option number one. And the second option is to hide under a rock and to pretend that nothing is going on. It's like a business as usual. But that's a way that leads to nowhere. If you ask for my opinion, humans don't really have a choice. It is a rat race. You either babysit your own replacement or you disappear. And that's exactly what makes it the most profitable business idea of all times. Don't forget to subscribe.